Gwen has just given us a good overview of how the overall U.S. economy is faring. Let's take a look now at a much smaller sector of it. It involves that ever-increasing number of small businesses, shops, and startups around the country that are a bit hipper, more skilled, locally based, and creative in their approaches. But as popular as they may be, are they generating more jobs, and are they well-paying ones? Our economics correspondent Paul Solman explores those questions and others, part of his reporting on making sense of financial news.
Brooklyn, New York. It's gone from backwater borough to capital of cutting-edge cool, and to a supposedly new breed of jobs, signified in part by hipsters in the business of handcrafting. Single-source chocolate bars, sprinkled with sea salt from the coast of Maine. Spicy pickles based on Grandma Lala's secret recipe. All natural, all handmade. Helping house this corner of the new so-called artisan economy, the old Pfizer factory in Brooklyn's Williamsburg. Vacated by the big pharma giant in 2008, it's now a small business incubator, home to dozens of startups. On the floor that local legend has it, Viagra was once concocted, some claim at this very lab bench, Kombucha Brooklyn, co-founded by a microbiology major, is brewing a different kind of pick-me-up, tea-based probiotic drinks and kits for making them at home.
Ready for a popsicle?
Yeah, yeah.
Just down the hall, David Carell of People's Pops.
Here's what we do. Fresh green market fruits transformed into summer on a stick.
Carell, 31, majored in communications at Florida State University. Made it to the mainstream media.
I was a researcher for Diane Sawyer.
And why'd you leave?
It was 2008, so at covering the news, you knew what was coming.
The crash of 08, he means, and the jobs it took with it. Luckily for Carell, he and two friends had been tinkering with an artisanal alternative, monetizing their popsicle passion. The partners now employ 45 people, making up to 20,000 pops a week. Rhode Island School of Design grad Bethany Obrecht crafted her commitment to animal rescue into a leash and collar business with a message.
If you see a dog that's walking down the street and the dog is using a Found My Animal leash, you know that that dog was adopted. And you know that its owner supports animal adoption.
Found My Animal now employs 10, though Obrecht herself is still struggling.
I still work a second job, but everyone here is making a living.
Now these days, startups expect a decent incubator to sport a ping pong table. I learned how far my game has fallen by sparring with the man who helped buy and transform the Pfizer plant, Ashish Dua.
We have over 60 artisanal manufacturers that have moved here in the last 2 years. I'd say over a dozen of them have already expanded their business. And you're talking about a lot of college-educated people who have thought through this problem and made a financial decision to take care of their own future by building a business that they're passionate about.
And what's the problem with their future?
The basic problem is the decline of what have been the traditional middle-class jobs, the hollowing out of the middle of our economy, and trying to find a new way to provide upward mobility for the typical American.
And it's not just blue-collar jobs, says economist Larry Katz, who has given the new artisan economy its name.
The bottom half of jobs of college graduates has been just as affected by this as the top half of jobs of non-college graduates. They were the middle management jobs, sales jobs. A lot of those are exactly what new information technology is very good at replacing.
But the artisan economy offers other options, not just in small-scale production, but also in services.
So if we had bed bugs, this would get rid of them.
This would kill all the stages of bedbugs.
Meet my artisanal exterminators, Colin Hickey and Todd McNamara, proprietors of Green Planet Pest Control. Both college grads, neither one ever imagined a career in extermination, even if it is environmentally friendly.
I went to college for a biology degree, and then when I finished my undergraduate, basically I didn't really have a plan of what I wanted to do.
Todd McNamara was a business major, tried his hand at selling stocks.
But I just didn't like the idea of sitting in front of a computer all day, watching numbers bounce around and calling clients and, you know, pretending like I liked them.
Instead, the would-be biologist and businessman are content turning couches into killing fields and growing their two-man operation. But did they need college for that?
I mean, I couldn't do what I do now if I didn't go to college.
Controlling the pests is the easy part, but, you know, this doing the marketing, the business strategy, the managing all the accounts, the day-to-day operation.
I actually think it may be that a really strong liberal arts education is going to be more valuable in the future. How well do you deal with unstructured problems, and how well do you deal with new situations? That's what's really key.
Carrie Mills got so creative with her career, she created a new profession. After studying business at Arizona State and returning home to New York, she felt a religious calling to work with older people in nursing homes, but was bummed by what she saw.
There's no enthusiasm, there's no encouragement to go live your life, still be who you are.
So Mills enthusiastically transformed herself into what she calls a dementia coach, training both staff and private clients on how to care for people like 93-year-old Grace Caffrey, who have Alzheimer's or related disabilities.
Nice shot, Grace, nice shot.
Caffrey's devoted niece, Mary Lucchese, visits nearly every day.
What are some of Grace's challenges now?
I think the biggest issue is when they have to touch her, whether it's the shower, or the toileting, or anything in there.
Yeah.
That's where the problems are.
Most people react when somebody goes to touch them. It's actually a defense mechanism.
Right.
So we
right.
also have to look in the situation to say, well, where can I give her a little bit more space that she can be more independent?
Carrie Mills has dozens of tips that I very much wish I'd heard when I cared for my parents, which suggests the job possibilities in an aging and therefore fraying population.
Astronomical. There's a ton of jobs out there that you just have to go figure it out. You have to kind of craft it in your community.
But can the average college grad carve out his or her own career?
I think every human being, for the most part, has that capability. The key is having a foundational set of skills, some of them interpersonal, some of them analytical, and finding what turns you on.
But you hear people more and more now saying to college graduates, don't follow your bliss. Don't do what you love, because that's impractical.
There's different levels of do what you love. You don't want to just do something because it looks like today there's a safe job in it. You want to do something that you wake up every morning and feel passionate about. And that doesn't guarantee there'll be a market for it, but it's, in many cases, it gives you a good shot.
And speaking of good shots, one last example of artisanship.
Yeah, it's just delicious.
Lawyers Zach Silverman and Alex Ryan worked for the same firm, bonded over their childhood love of frozen slushies.
They're not as socially acceptable for a law firm, so we sort of joke, why isn't there a good frozen slushie that we could bring to the office?
Ryan bought a machine for his home, started developing flavors, citrus, ginger, tea. When he got laid off in 2009, Kelvin Slushie was born, starting with a food truck.
People kept coming to the truck and bringing their own booze, and they would spike the slushies.
So your eureka was adult slushies. Wait a second, that would be alcohol.
Exactly.
Silverman has since quit the law firm, joining Ryan full time. Regrets? They've had few.
I love what I do. I'm much more passionate about what I'm doing day in and day out.
We hope that we're building equity in a company that will be worth hopefully more in the future.
But will they ever earn lawyer money? And more importantly for this story, will artisanal businesses create enough jobs to rebuild America's middle class? We note that at its peak, the Pfizer plant employed some 2,500 people. Its artisan replacements, just 1,000 jobs so far. On the other hand, the space is still only 40% leased. If it hits its full occupancy, there just might be 2,500 people working here once again.
So why should young people today want a liberal arts education? You can read more of Paul's interview with the man who coined the term artisan economy. That's on Making Sense.